discussion this morning is going to come from 1 John 3 and verse 1. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew not him. Now it's not happenstance that love is essential to men's well-being and being well-adjusted. A lot of maladies are present among the race of men because of this not being, it's not properly displayed. Now, how could we be in his image without having need of his love and a capacity to respond to him with desire, affection, and those qualities that love produces? It says, God is love. Now, how do you relate to or serve or fellowship with a God who is love if it's absent in you? This is a very far-reaching quality. It's seen in a little bit different light when we're talking about being godly. Now, what we want to do is behold the manner of the love that he has loved us with. So it's immediately a large thing, both in scope and in importance, as well of great value, because one, it's bestowed, and two, because of who bestowed it. You can't get this anywhere else. And the Father, not another creature, not a lesser being, the Father himself has bestowed this love upon us. Yeah. And of course, the effects of this, that we should be called the sons of God. Now, it's said in the scripture that he that denieth the Son, the same hath not the Father. So that when we consider the manner of the love, we are going to necessarily consider the Father, but we're going to have to consider the entire Godhead, and particularly Christ himself. Love is neither idle nor ineffective. Unless we rightly comprehend it, though, we will of necessity pervert it, for it cannot be denied. This is essential in the makeup of man, this requirement for and this need to express, because it's part of the image of God that we bear. All things are made for God's pleasure and have been assigned function and purpose. When God made it, he decided, this is what you're going to do, and this is my purpose for having made you. Now, man was uniquely made in his image. We might consider three questions right at this point. Like, to whom do angels minister? They minister to God, and they minister to those that shall be the heirs of salvation. For whom did Christ die? He died on behalf of the Father, that the purpose of God would be fulfilled, but he died for us who are saved. And in whom does the Godhead dwell? Well, the Godhead dwelt together as one, but now we have been put into the Godhead in a very particular way that we're not aware of any other creature participates in this. We actually are partakers of the Godhead. All right, now you go, what manner of love? Well, we're talking about the manner of love, both in what we were created for and the implications of this, the bearing the image of God. So this has a lot to do with what God does, who he does things with, what he wants, how he conducts his affairs. It says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. So these, if we've gotten anything good, and every quality of love, there's no quality of love as God initially created it to be, as he initially put it in us, there is no quality of love that's negative. Can't say anything bad about it.
Yeah. Very good.
Now, the work of salvation is so great that it demonstrates the love of the Father and the Word/Son, because this was determined in the councils of heaven before he was prepared a body and came to earth in the likeness of sinful flesh, not as sinful flesh. And it is made manifest, it's continuing to be made manifest, this love, in those he has and is saving. So again, we have this image. We see it, the Son loved the Father and did the will of the Father, did always those things that pleased the Father. The Father loved the Son. We know that because he was raised from the dead. And besides other things, but that's the period on the end of the sentence there. And now we, as his sons, he's given us to be called sons. Now this same quality of God is being made manifest through his people. Amen. So you see that these things have a lot of implication. Yes.
Yes, there's nothing in Scripture, I believe, that comments on the love of God prior to redemption.
Mm-hmm.
And it appears as though for God to manifest his love, grace and mercy had to play a role in this.
Mm-hmm.
In this, and so he made man, then by grace he recreated man so he could bear this more precise likeness of the love of God. But the interplay of grace and mercy with this love is only God could do this.
Yes.
As far as we know, he doesn't say he loved the angels. Not because they were unlovable, but because they're a different kind of creation. They were not a likeness of himself.
That's right. Amen.
But not man, in the same way.
That's
yeah.
That's right. But man, so that the creation was in view of the recreation.
That's right.
That's why we're told not to love the world. See, that's because that's of the creation. But now we're in the recreation.
Yeah.
Amen.
And in the recreation, that's where grace and love operate.
That's right. Because that is in the Son.
That's right. That's what,
so we're still seeing this relation of the Godhead to one another in the redemption of man.
Yes.
Brother Robert?
Yeah, the manner you just was talking about of love is made known, and what the love accomplishes in those who it's been targeted to reap some kind of an effect. So, and in your case, we're talking about that we should be sons. So, I mean, that was a very precise target.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it wasn't like a scattered thing. That love was focused.
That's right.
On a purpose, and it will come to pass, because God's love is demonstrating it has the capacity to do this work in those people.
Amen. Amen. Now, many of the admonitions of Scripture, when received, will guide us in our understanding of the manner. Because God, this love, it's not like a term you can just take and just throw out everywhere. The love of God is very specific. And while it, from one perspective, it's very broad, from another perspective, it's very precise. Because it's copious. It's abundant. But it is, as Brother Robert would say, it has a target. He doesn't just love everything for any reason.
This is another unique trait of God. In the world, abundance equates with waste. Wherever there's an abundance, there's some kind of waste. But in this abundance, there isn't.
That's right.
There isn't waste at all.
That's
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Because it's being directed by God's wisdom. So I just thought it would be, and you probably will have some that you can think of you may want to add to this list, because it's by no means exhaustive. It says, be ye kind one to another.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Why? Because the love of God provoked his kindness toward us.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Forgive, as the Father for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. This is bearing his image.
Amen.
These are not just rules, you know, of conduct where God says, okay, I've done a lot for you now, and so here are the rules, and I expect you to keep them. This, he's teaching us how to be like him in a more understanding way, so that we don't just keep a rule and not know why we're keeping it, but where we can enter into fellowship into his character. Right. Sister Ada?
Manner of love, it can go beyond just meaning what sort of love,
right,
to like what country does it come from. There's a place of origin,
right,
which it comes from, and that the Father has bestowed upon us, our progenitor, if you will. He's the beginning and creator of a new man.
That's right.
That we are, and so his very spirit, he's the one who gives us his very spirit,
mm-hmm,
and governs our minds and puts his own affections in our hearts. So we're learning what is the manner, not the love of the world.
Mm-mm.
We know about the love of the world and the things that are in the world, and we are not to be in fellowship with that. But what manner of love has the Father, our Father,
that's right,
bestowed upon us?
And as we go into this, what we're learning really is the Father.
Amen.
Yes.
Sister Melissa.
I was thinking along those lines too. We're actually being changed. So mm-hmm, this manner, right, of love changes us. It's,
yes,
it's not like we, like you said, kind. Well, maybe before we could be kind, and sometimes it was a forced kindness. But the Lord changes us so we actually are kind.
That's right.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
Right.
That's right.
Brother Ricky.
Yeah, the love of God was spoken about and demonstrated under the Old Covenant.
Mm-hmm.
For he said of Israel, he says, I have loved thee with an everlasting love.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. See, but it was in like a very abbreviated or limited scope.
Right.
From which most of the time the love was being shown by the Father and not reciprocated.
Right.
Yes.
See, or not
so
understood.
He would draw them.
Yeah.
He would deliver them. He would guide them, and they would be unthankful.
Yeah.
It was restricted because of the need for redemption. It's like his justice held back because of the need.
Yeah.
Right.
For sin to be paid for, but beyond that, there was a need for humanity to have the capacity both to receive and give this love. And so that's what's so necessary in the new birth and in being called the sons of God, which is what we are,
right,
is so that we can receive and reciprocate this love to the Lord.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah. See, the love toward Israel didn't change them.
No.
That's right.
It actually hardened them.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but, you know, we have some very notable exceptions that we're grateful for, but they were, as Paul would say, they were straightened in their own bowels.
That's right.
That was the limitation. Flesh was the limitation. So there were things that God could and eventually would, and he would make that way, do in and for mankind that he was restrained from, because he'd have to break forth on them in judgment and in punish their unrighteousnesses. Yes, Brother Jonathan.
When we're looking at this whole manner of love, we're looking at a love that's actually done something for those it's been shown to.
Yes.
Because in Hosea, he totally said, take in Gomer, and every time she goes with another man, just take her back.
Yeah.
And that's what I've been doing with these people. When we're saying, behold what manner of love, that's not what we're looking at. We're not looking like, I'm just taking you back.
That's
you're unfaithful,
right.
You're going to keep going to other people, but I'm just going to keep taking you back. It's actually a love. It's actually produced a faithful people. It's actually like transformed the way people live. So, I mean, like, behold, a manner of love. We're looking at like a big work in that love that's been demonstrated.
So, going along with that, you could say that he has put his love in us, and now we're seeing the outworking of that in these things what are we for if it is not that when people behold the church that they see the God of that church? And Brother Gene?
I was going to say, the church has short-circuited this
understanding of transformation.
Yes.
They're hanging on to what Brother Jonathan just said from the Old Covenant. Mm-hmm. God just keep taking you back, no matter what you do, he'll just keep taking. They're preaching a gospel, a supposed gospel like that.
But see, they don't understand the manner
of
this love.
Yeah,
that's right.
And so they don't really understand God. Brother Given and then Sister Melissa.
Yeah, this when he loved Israel, it wasn't the same kind of love that we have in Christ Jesus, because it didn't alter them or change them.
Yes.
Now David, who was a man after God's own heart, he didn't see this either.
Mm-hmm.
He said, "What's man that thou art mindful of him?" He's thinking of man, flesh and blood man, that's what he's thinking about.
Mm-hmm.
What is man that thou art mindful of him? See, this is not the way it is in Christ Jesus. We don't marvel at humanity.
Mm-hmm.
We marvel at the new creation.
Amen.
That was with him. Divine love couldn't change anybody.
That's right.
Unless there was this redemption that's in it.
Mm-hmm.
It's what Jesus did that enables this love to be blossomed.
Amen.
And what we're talking about today will help a person bridge that in their thinking process to understand why God couldn't do it before Christ. I mean, it's good to know and essential to know what happens and how things are, but it is even more profitable when we understand why and can have agreement with it. Sister Melissa, you?
Yeah, I was thinking that, you know, who of us hasn't seen a person that we would say, if they could only be like this, we know it would be for their good.
Mm-hmm.
Well, see, the Lord, he can do that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like you said before, he couldn't because of sin and things.
That's right.
So he has the power to actually change people.
Mm-hmm.
And he's doing it. We don't have that kind of power, but since we've experienced this, that should give us great joy in speaking about these things, offering this out to people that they could see what God has to offer.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
And love has implication to all of this. Brother Marty.
Another way to look at this, I think, is that in the old times, there was no reference for love.
That's right.
The ancients' thinking of love was based on the commandment of God. All they had was the Lord's commandments.
That's right.
So it was an earthly love, you know, until Christ came.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that he redefined that love.
Yeah, and we are talking a bit about being brought to God. We had to be brought there. There was no getting there by ourselves.
Amen.
There was no way for man to find that. We had to be brought, and the Savior hadn't come yet. So experientially, they were hindered. They could only go as far as the commandments could take them.
Amen. Then under the law of Israel got close, they inevitably they provoked God.
Mm-hmm.
Inevitably. He was provoked. Finally, he says, I can't tolerate what you're doing for me anymore.
Well, see, but they were dragging his name into reproach.
Yeah.
I think of David whenever he had the judgment of God against him. Of course, David responded in a very godly manner. He gave thanks that he wasn't cast off from the Lord. But God told him that the punishment was going to be public and severe because he had given occasion for God's enemies to reproach him.
Yes.
That's a very severe thing. And the church needs to be very aware of that too, how we are representing the name of Christ and of God. But God still, because he is love. Now see, you can't think of love just like soft, fluffy, fuzzy stuff. Okay? That's why I'm saying. And I'm not saying there's not a nice, soft, fluffy side to love. Okay? But that can't be your basis of something. The basis cannot be found in ourselves. It has to be found in God if it is going to be the manner of love that God has bestowed. And it'll provoke things in us that maybe people don't go back and make a reference to. But if you understand what's going on, you realize it's because you've been changed into God's image. And this is kind of like how love works. You just, love is kind.
Mm-hmm.
It is. So You, whenever the scriptures admonish us, be ye kind one to another, that's let the love of God, which is shed abroad in our hearts, express itself like God would express it. So that God can be glorified in us.
Right. One of the differences between law and grace under law, what you're told to do and you strive to do that. Right. But under grace, you're told what God, what Christ did,
mm-hmm.
and what it accomplished, and in view of that, you do this. See, that's all, it's completely different.
Amen.
Completely
oh, yeah.
different. But where you've got it, where the church has to be continually admonished, do what's right, stop doing this, stop
right.
doing that. See, they're off base.
That's right.
They're skewed in the wrong direction, and it's never going to happen that way, no matter how skilled a speaker may be.
Okay, let's look at that last scripture that we referenced. Forgive one another as God, for Christ's sakes, have forgiven us. All right. Now, when God looks at us, he looks at what Jesus accomplished. And for his sake,
that's right.
because he loved the Son, he said, all right, they're forgiven. But now when we have to forgive, we need to raise in the same way God does.
Right.
We look at Christ and say, look what he did.
That's right.
And so how can I not? This is, see, it's bringing
right.
God and people together. We're like doing the same thing, not on the same level, of course. God forgave so much more than anything we would ever have to forgive. But I'm saying it's the likeness, it's the manner of what's happening here. Let's see, I think I had Sister Danielle and then Brother Ricky.
In Proverbs 30, it says in 18:19, there are three things which are too wonderful for me. Yes, four, which I do not understand. And one of those things is the way of a man with a maid, the way of a man with a woman. And also in Song of Solomon, we see a metaphor of God, you know, in a bride and a groom, we also see the metaphor of us with the relationship with God. And if the love of a man and a woman is too wonderful to even consider all the implications of it, this spiritual love, this love from God, is so far and beyond anything that we can actually comprehend. It's really beyond. And it's interesting that we have these metaphors to look back on to kind of try to understand in our minds this pursuit, actually, this love, this great love that God has for us, and then take it so much further with the spiritual implications in Scripture. I just love those metaphors. They kind of give me a basis for my mind to understand this precious love that the Father does have for us and the way he pursues us. And the way
yeah,
he
he's received us to himself, not
to
just
himself.
To his presence.
Right.
Brother Ricky?
Yeah, we are started to fight the good fight of faith, lay hold on eternal life. That's what Brother Gibb was talking about.
Yeah.
See, eternal life is something that's not, it's not just like automatic. It's something
yeah.
that you have to get hold of by faith.
That's right.
And faith has to have an affirmation. God has done something.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
And when men declare without speculation what God has said he has done and what would result from that, that gives the people of God the ability to lay hold on eternal life. You don't have the whole of it yet. You have part of it.
Part of it, that's right.
And you spend your life laying hold on the whole of it, but it's in the context of affirmation and declaration of what God has said he has done.
Mm-hmm.
If we fall into what Brother Gibbon had talked about, we get into this we should and we ought know, it actually obscures eternal life.
That's right.
And
Amen.
You will not be able to lay hold on
Amen.
It.
In which case, what we're talking about is pretty much a moot point. There's no point in talking to people who have not believed on Christ to talk about God's love. I mean, it's just like wrong message. Let's talk about something that pertains to you.
That's confirmed. The word love isn't mentioned in the book of Acts. There's no, we have no record of anybody preaching to anybody that told them about God's
that's
love.
Right.
It's just,
yeah.
that,
true.
You don't want to draw wrong conclusions from that, but that, these are just like the facts.
That's
you
right.
have to reason on these facts.
That's right.
Why is it that the only people that were told about God's love were people that God was interested in and saved?
Yeah.
Nicodemus was told some because he'd made some inquiry.
Mm-hmm.
And he was told a new birth. But see, there's It's not spoken of to people that are off in a distance. This is not what draws you to God.
This is family talk. This is for the family.
Your perception of the love of God is not what draws you to God.
Right.
Okay, Brother Tony?
This is true because
the provision had to be made.
That's right.
For God's love. It was in Christ Jesus. And we talked about this, that's right. Just earlier you said that our forgiveness is right and others. That's because the provision has been made. Mm-hmm. God can forgive men because of Jesus Christ's provision.
Amen.
We can forgive one another because of Jesus Christ's provision.
That's right.
Amen.
And of course, that's what we're talking about. God made provision to bestow His love on us.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Now, He's made the provision, but now what we're doing here, when we say, behold the manner, we are entering into, like, looking at it and understanding it and being able to make the connections because of it.
Right.
We're not it's already been established that God made the way, that it had to be made, that nobody can do it, that this is for the household of faith. This is an in-house topic.
Yes.
I'm sorry if anybody's without and they're trying to understand this. You never will. You won't. Until you yourself participate in it.
Right.
And so this is participating in our understanding as well as in our hearts, this manner of love that God has bestowed upon us.
Yes.
Brother Ricky.
And it's declared to be the love of God that is in Christ Jesus.
That's
Amen.
Right.
Yeah.
That's right. Right. And I hope that is coming across, that nobody has even suggested that anything that we have of eternal consequence or substance, anything, we possess none of it outside of Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
Brother Robert, Mrs. Sister.
Yeah, as we walk in this love and start to understand the manner, it actually produces in us a desire to find reasons to forgive people and find reasons to bless them and lift them up. This is just something that will be provoked in you. And that this is it being manifested in you.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, it will produce that fruit.
Yeah.
See now, and then too, and because I know that you've got this in your thinking as you say that, but God hates iniquity. So the manner of love is not to excuse iniquity, but to be gracious at every possible point. Where there is any just cause for mercy or graciousness or kindness, that we would find it like God finds it.
Amen.
But it has to be a just cause for it.
Right.
Not a lie, not an iniquity, not a transgression. We're not talking about that. But again, we're talking about people who have received this blessing from God through Christ Jesus and are walking by faith. And so this is like expanding ourselves, maturing ourselves, growing up into our fellowship, our cognitive fellowship with God. God gave us a brain for Him, and so that we can see what He's doing. We can discern Him. We can give Him praises that actually glorify Him. I've said this before, not everyone heard it, but whenever I was first brought back into the Lord, I believed, and then this congregation, it was one of the congregations that they just, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Well, I got nothing against praising the Lord, obviously, but that was all there was to it.
Yes.
It was never what for. It just, praise the Lord. I'm just praising the Lord. Praise God. Praise the Lord. I'm thinking, okay, I'm waiting for the rest of it now. What did He do? And I never heard it. See, praise is insightful.
Yes.
Praise is the response of something that we have seen or understood about God, and we can articulate it. Brother Jeremy.
Yeah, when you said we have a brain for the Lord, we have a mind for the Lord, and given to us for the Lord, this is why we were created. Was to be for Him.
That's right.
So as we excel in Christ and we hate what God hates and love what He loves, that's when we're on the right track.
Yeah.
And it's not that we It's our job to go around and tell people how they're not on the right track. I mean, we're peaceable with all men, but if our lives don't exhibit what the Lord has done in us, there's something wrong.
Amen.
We're not on the right track.
That's right. Because it works, like we said at the very beginning, that love is neither idle nor ineffective.
That's right.
Love is not idle. It'll work in you.
Yes, it's productive.
Okay, somebody had a hand up, Sister Ada.
That exhortation, behold, draws attention to the fact that something was accomplished so that more could be accomplished. And in this love of God, we are made children of God. And the apostle here will reason that each one has this hope in himself, that has this hope in himself, purifies himself.
Yeah.
So there, something was done. God did something based on his own work.
That's right.
And then we're also engaged in that in our own response.
Yeah. Okay, now, Sister Melissa, did you have your hand up? All right, this side, hands, Brother Given.
You notice there that the love of God is... It isn't like a point in time when he just did something.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's what it wrought or what it produced.
Amen.
Right.
That's the point.
That's right.
But if you just listen, you'll hear people talking about the love of God, and they'll talk about it as though it were a point in time when Christ died.
Uh-huh.
See, but the love of God that was exhibited at that time, but it was planned beforehand.
That's right.
It resulted.
That's right.
In something. And that's the thing that makes God's love different.
Amen.
For God so loved the world, he gave.
He gave.
Jesus was the Word who became Christ.
What is man
the lamb slain?
Mindful of him.
Yeah.
We say, who is Jesus?
We
are mindful of him.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, here's another exhortation or admonition. Do good to all men.
Yeah.
Especially of the household of faith.
Amen.
All right, Brother James, he addressed this. He says that, I wrote down the wrong thing here. No, I didn't. All right. What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and have not works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled. Notwithstanding ye give them not those things which are needful to the body, what doth it profit?
Yes.
How have you done good? That's an area where we can do good. This was the household of faith here we're talking about, a brother or a sister. And why would we do that? Why would we do good to all men? Because God causes it to rain on the just and the unjust.
Yeah.
And he'll judge the ones that are thorns and thistles, but he gives to all men many things. He's good to all men, but especially to those of the household of faith. And yes, and even in Israel, it was said, he that toucheth you toucheth the apple of my eye. That's the very center part there. So, and then also, it says, beloved, let us love one another.
Mm-hmm.
Now, see if you don't understand what we're talking about yet. How do you love one another? You smile at them and just be nice when we greet each other? How do you love one another? You love one another as Christ loved us.
Amen.
Which is according to the Father's righteousness and holiness and his name being everything that we do. It can't step outside of those bounds for our love to be appropriate, for it to be considered by the Father. You know, we're not against anybody being kind, but if they don't have, if they're not doing it because they have been, they realize God has bestowed this love on them. They're doing it as unto the Father through Christ. Well, in that day, they're going to be in that category when they said, well, we've done many wonderful things, and we've done this and done, you know, I was very kind to them, and they were really mean to me. And God said, Jesus said, I never knew you. You didn't have me in mind when you did that. Go get credit for who you did it for. You know, so this love is, it's not wimpy love.
Amen.
It is being conformed to the image of the Father.
Amen.
And so when we see what Christ does, what he did, why he did it, these are the things that we are being made like. We don't have to go, ooh, now I can't remember. What am I supposed to do now? This love works in us to produce these things. So when we see brethren, we have a natural inclination to love those who love Christ.
That's right.
So, all right. And then somebody already mentioned this one, love not the world. Why? Because the world hated our Savior. The world hates God. God does not love the world. What basis do we have for loving the world? See, this is not this, let's just, now be kind to them, do good to everybody, but don't love them. Not if they don't love your Savior. They're the enemy of your Savior, brother.
Just on that previous thought. To love the world, for a believer to really love the world, they have to adapt to it in some way. I mean, there has to be some kind of a compromise and change to adjust to how to that environment in order for it to really accept it. So love not the world. It's like saying don't adapt to what's, this isn't natural to you anymore.
That's right.
It's not even part of you. So like don't go back to it and shape your life around something that you're not even really a part of or meant to be in.
That's right.
But that also, that other thing you said about loving the brethren, you just kind of elaborated like, well, how do we do that? Well, scriptures tell us, like, let us love one another, for love is of God. Never let love is born of God. That let us, I mean, that's something that's done by faith. I mean, this is natural to new creation. Because that's what he said, is that love is of God. So, I mean, like, the natural result of that is if you are of God, this is like an evidence of that. That's a response of that. Yeah. You're drawn to people that are like him. So he says, let us, like, let that, like, have free course, so to speak.
Mm-hmm. All right, like, okay, Brother Tony.
I'm just going to say, you know, you don't have to be out there very long to hear men say that God so loved the world, but then we're told not to love the world. And they like to bring this up as like a contradiction. But, you know, only God's love is focused in a purpose.
That's right.
So that they can actually, you know, actually accomplish something, and so then he's able to manage this in such a way that it's not, it's like we talked about a while ago, it's a different kind of thing we're talking about.
Well, see, the love of God was manifested in Christ before the entire world. It was there for all men to see and behold, but not everybody took hold of it by faith. They wouldn't believe what was going on, even though it was declared to them. So, in that respect, they've rejected God. Brother Gene, Sister Katie, and then Brother Given.
The love of God, Brother Paul says here in Romans chapter 5, involves the justice of God.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just tolerance. It's not overlooking.
Mm-hmm.
It's justice. So this is how he deals with wickedness and evil and sin in man. Justice. Of course, it's in Christ Jesus. See, we've already said that. It was in him. And now you've got to come to the Son. You've got to kiss the Son. You've got to acknowledge the Son.
Amen.
And believe in the Son. Or you get nothing from God.
Amen.
Okay. Amen.
The world likes to take God so loved the world and change that into unconditional love that God has for us. And if God had unconditional love for us, there would be no need for change.
That's right.
And then, once we do change, we're called to persevere. In Jude, it says, keep yourselves in the love of God.
Mm-hmm.
And by doing that, we are kept by God.
Amen.
That's right. Amen. Brother Given, and then Brother Justin.
God so loved the world is humanity.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Project humanity. He's not thinking about individuals. He's thinking about collective humanity. Mm-hmm. Love not the world. That's the world order, the world system. See, it's a different.
That's right.
It's a different type of thing.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
God so loved the world, he offered everybody a way out. Now, if after the world, after men living in the world have rejected the way out, what could you possibly give to them that could save them or change them?
Mm-hmm. Right. Yep. Mm-hmm. Brother Jonathan?
A provisional wealth.
Yeah. Right.
Yes. It wasn't a personal.
That's right.
Yes. Yeah. Provisional.
Right.
Brother Jonathan?
To be more specific about don't love this world, he's telling you don't attach or don't embrace anything that's of this order that's not crossing over into the new creation.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and we were talking about the perversion of love. Loving the world is entering into a perversion. It's not of the Father. So we don't, you know, this is dangerous. This is dangerous. You don't fiddle with that and not get burned. So there is the love of God, and there is the love that is of the world, which is really no love. It's kind of like a gospel that's no gospel. It isn't steadfast and secure and founded, and it's not. Somebody can say, oh, I just love you, I just love you, and the next minute they've turned their back on you, and they're telling people awful stuff about you, or they're trying to hurt you, or they're willing to take advantage of you financially. This is that person that just loved you, but it wasn't the right kind of love. It was a perverse love. It was founded in what I need, what I want, what makes me feel good.
Yeah.
So who had their hand up over here? Brother Isaac.
I was just thinking that we were not created to love things that God didn't love.
That's
we were created just for God, for him to indwell in us. And
yeah.
God does indwell or have part in things that are against him. And I remember in
Amen.
Romans 8, it says, the world is at enmity with God, and it can't love God, neither be once, it's not subject to God, neither
That's right.
can be. And so the world was created just like a training ground for us, just to get closer, just to get away from Satan and then closer on the Christ, but we weren't made for this world. I remember Brother Gibbon talking about, like, it's just like a microcosm, just training us for bigger and better things to come
mm-hmm.
in the world to come.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Brother Robert.
And the manifestation of this kind of love in the believer as you walk with Christ becomes so sensitive and so precise that when you read, we ought to bear one another's burdens.
Yeah.
It will provoke you not just to enter and say, I'm going to do this for you, but to come up underneath them, help. You're not taking over, you're helping.
Mm-hmm.
And,
yeah.
and when that is manifested, when the person sees that you are joining in with them, this transfer of this mercy and this care
yeah.
is felt
mm-hmm.
by both parties.
Mm-hmm.
And you can grow in this ability to be able to be used by God.
Yeah, we see in the Godhead the Paraclete that comes along and ministers the things of God to us. So, okay, and then just the last one that I just jotted down here was have not the love of God with respect to persons.
Yeah.
Why? Because God is not a respecter of persons.
Amen.
So see, this love operates, this manner of love is after the character and nature of God.
Amen.
That's the manner of it.
Yes,
I like what Sister Ada brought up about the source of it. It's a heavenly quality. It's not of the earth, earthy. Now, God is too large for any of his creation to view and discern. None of what he created could just, you know, if God would give them a look, let them behold him, they wouldn't go, okay, now I know all about God. I've got him figured out now. He's big. And he's complex. It says, there are many ways in which he makes himself known. Now, everything as originally created, formed, was formed to that end, that God may be known. Even when creatures, plants, and inanimate things not given the powers of cognition were observed, and the handiwork of God those that did, it's like he created some things, like a rock doesn't know about God, although he can cause them to praise him if he so desired. You know, you go to your geranium and it's not going to be able to tell you anything about God. But there's something that God did that if you have a mind that is, that you can see God's handiwork. So he created some things that can't. They're not capable of that. But they were still created for his glory because he created other beings that could look at it and glorify God for what he did.
That's right.
So you don't worship nature. What you do is you take what God has put in you and your understanding, and you bring everything in subjection to that understanding, and then you can proclaim the works of God. There are wonderful, wonderful works of God, but that's why we see in the creation his eternal power and Godhead. We're supposed to see something when we look at it.
That's right. Amen.
And men have intentionally perverted that in our day. So this is all for the glory of God. Now, before we move on, I wanted to rehearse this one. As we have borne the image of the earthy, so shall we bear the image of the heavenly. And that's what the love of God is working in us, this image of the heavenly. It's kind of something that makes sense of everything else. It's just kind of infused in everything. You can't, light, you know, there's several things that it just says categorically, God is. God is light. God is love. The knowledge of him is eternal. Jesus said, I am the truth. I am the way. Not, I'm leading you on a way. I am the way. I am the life.
Yes.
So, you know, there's not a long list of those. And so whenever God says, I am, or Jesus said, you know, God is, or the apostles who were the spokesmen for Christ and opening things up, amplifying things afterwards, whenever they were given more understanding, that whenever you say God is, that you pick your ears up on that, you know, is something that is pervasive in our knowledge of God. So the most perfect revelation of the love of God is manifested in Christ. I mean, he came, and as far as us being able to see it, in the flesh we see the love of God, what manner it is, so that we know what manner of love he's bestowed upon us. And of course, we know the manner as far as the way as Jesus, but we also see that in him, he did the things that love provokes. Yes.
If God didn't declare it, we wouldn't be able to see it.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
I can just testify for myself that I've known since I was a small boy, for God so loved the world. I've known about the love of God to some degree since I was 5 years old. But it wasn't until later I began to see, comprehend.
That's right.
The love of God. And that's what's important is, if you just tell people Christ now loved you and died for your sins, that will yield zero.
That's right.
It's got to be expounded.
Amen.
It's got to be opened up because it's too high. See, it's outside the perimeter of human experience.
It's too high.
Yeah. So it has to be expounded. And the apostles, that's what they did. They expounded this love we're talking about. They expounded it and showed how effective it was, how expansive it was.
And that's what we're doing. We're heeding that admonition to behold it.
Amen.
Don't assume it.
Yes.
Don't just assume that you know everything that there is to know about the love of God. We can all grow in our knowledge of this. And as we do, it's going to coincide perfectly with our knowledge of God himself. Brother Aaron.
Yeah, I thought several times this morning during the conversation that the John asking us to behold means there's something to see. There's, there's more that we have not haven't yet comprehended. And the what you had just said about creation, you know, you don't see it. What God put in creation, you don't see it unless you look. In fact, you don't see it unless that's open to us as well. Because that was Paul's point in Romans chapter 1, is that these things are evident, yet nobody saw it. Nobody came to the right conclusion, even though the knowledge was there. It wasn't seen. It wasn't comprehended. So knowing the love of God is not taken for granted. The Apostle Paul prayed, Ephesians chapter 3, he prayed that the brethren would be rooted and grounded in love. And the reason was so that they could comprehend.
That's right.
That means it actually takes strength to understand, to comprehend the love of God. If a person's not grounded, if we are not grounded, then the love of God will elude us. Now that says something about what it is we're comprehending. We have to be strengthened to comprehend.
That's
like
right.
We see this in the Revelation with John, that the angel had to strengthen him and, you know, pick him up so he could receive the revelation.
That's right.
And you see that in Daniel as well. Daniel, there's no strength left in him in the presence of the angel, and the angel strengthened him to receive what God had given him. Now, so that, I mean, there's so much in that that we're dependent on God to receive what he's opened up.
Amen. Brother Jonathan.
Yeah, Christ is the means by which the love of, like, expounding Christ, that's really how the love of God is really going to be perceived at all. Because I remember in Malachi where he says, I have loved you, and Israel said, well, how have you loved us? Now, if you tell people, talk about God's love, you leave Christ out, that's what their response is going to be every time. How?
Yeah.
How have you loved us? That's where Christ has to be part of it, because that kind of... It kind of leaves a gap. There's like, he loves you, but there has to be some way for that to be taken hold of, and Christ is that means.
Yeah,
but that's the response, though. How have you loved us if your Christ is not part of that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, what we're talking about here, when you're talking about the love of God, if you're going to deal with it truthfully, you can't leave Christ out of any of it.
Right.
Like we said before, outside of Christ, you have nothing as it relates to God. Nothing. Not a little pinch.
Amen.
Not a little molecule. Not a little atom. Nothing. Just settle yourself on that. Yes. It's all in Christ.
Amen.
Salvation is of the Lord, and he has worked it in the Son. So,
Jesus said to his disciples, the Father's loved you because you loved me and believed I came out from God.
Yeah, John 17, we're going to go to that and pick up a few of those verses. Not that particular one, but yes, he has loved us. We are loved in the Beloved. So, and it's because that we have believed on him. So, all right, I just want to go to a few verses here. This is really... You talk about a rich field. This prayer of Christ before he went to the crucifixion is really rich. Now you think about it. These are the last words that he was going to have recorded before, except for, you know, just what he said to Pilate and stuff. But this, he's pouring his heart out to the Father. He's talking to the Father, not just saying things in front of men on behalf. This is what's in him to pray about to the Father as he's going there. And I'm going to skip through it. It says, these words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. So now that sets the context for this communication. He's going to glorify the Father. Then in 10... he says, and all mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. Now you try to take this out of the context of the love of the Father and the Son, and you have no context. It's just this mystery. And then the 14th verse, I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. See, this is going to cover a lot of the ground. And then verses 21 through 23. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one, I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. And then finally, verses 24 and 26. Father, I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. And I have declared unto them thy name, and will declare it, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. Now it's when Christ dwells in your heart by faith, and you have the indwelling of the Spirit, that you have the love of God, that kind of love, that manner of love. And God is going to be the focus of that love. He's going to be your consideration as you make determinations, what to say, what to do, who to be with. And it will not love, that love, Christ in you will not love the world. It will not.
Amen.
So when we say love not the world, we're really being called up to discern between clean and unclean, and profane and holy. We're being taught in these things. So this, in doing this, I just wanted to perhaps encourage us, not only in this area, but in this area, because it is such a large thing. It's so central to everything that believers are and hope for. You're not going to hope in a God you don't love.
Amen. That's right. Amen.
You're not even going to stay faithful to a God you don't love. We're wired that way because God, we're made in His image. And if you don't have fellowship with the truth, then you don't own that truth either. It's not really yours until you can enter into it and by faith have fellowship with it, agreement with God in it. So I just encourage us all, and you know, myself, I'm part of the all, to look into these things more deeply, make more connections between the love of God and our understanding of all of the Scripture, because love is intrinsic to knowledge of God.
Amen.
Love is intrinsic to the knowledge of God.
Amen. Amen. Do you remember there where you pray that God would open the eyes of your understanding?
Yeah, Brother Aaron mentioned that, yeah.
Yeah, I believe in Ephesians 3, yeah, he mentioned that. Sing you with might by your spirit, the inner man, that Christ be filled in your heart by faith, that you be rooted and grounded, may comprehend with all saints what is and what is the love of Christ that passes knowledge.
That's right.
The love of Christ which passes knowledge. It's human knowledge. This cannot be known academically or by definition. Or
it's known through union.
Or maybe by parallels, or it's can't be known. You're a union. That's the only way it can be known. And this prayer is an order we pray.
Amen.
Today.
Yes. Amen.
So the people that are aligned with Christ would have the eyes of understanding open up and be strengthened with might by God's Spirit in the inner man, so Christ can stay with them.
Yeah.
That Christ may dwell in your heart by faith. So receiving Christ, that's the beginning, not the ending. He's got to stay.
That's right.
But if you don't comprehend, He won't stay.
Right.
Amen.
Well, this is an area of great liberty and joy Oh boy, it makes any burden light when you can do it in love. Brother Aaron?
Anything that is of God, like God is love, God is light,
yeah.
God is righteous, God is just, holy, anything like that, that is, this is like some of the essentials of God. This is who he is.
That's right.
Not something that is just merely associated with him or a likeness. This is who he is.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we shouldn't expect anything like that to just be simple.
Right.
That you can just take hold of and just kind of, once you got it, you get it. And you never lose it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think a lot of people have trouble with something that you can understand, but you're not going to understand all of it.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have these texts about comprehending the love of God,
mm-hmm.
but then you have these texts about how unsearchable are his ways.
Mm-hmm.
Well, which way is it? It's both.
It's mm-hmm. both. Amen.
He is making the love, his love known to us. He's shedding it abroad in our hearts, and we're receiving of it, we're comprehending it, but no, we're not going to reach the end of it, we're not going to exhaust it
mm-hmm.
when we're in these bodies and in this world. We do not yet know as we are known.
That's right.
Yeah.
But see, that what appears to be an apparent contradiction, I think causes a lot of unnecessary argument between people. Like it has to be all or nothing, like you don't understand anything, or you can't, or you get it, you mm-hmm. get it all.
Yes. Well, those are times whenever wisdom would teach us that you lay your hand on your mouth and just whatever God said, you believe it, and then ask him to reconcile those things. But don't be ignorant and let everybody know it. Brother Tony, Brother Jonathan, Brother Gene, did you have your hand up?
Yes.
Okay. Brother Tony, Jonathan.
I'll think about the substitute. The world is off for the love of God. You have the love of the world, which is that the devil has handed this off as a substitute for the genuine love of God. Now, it's a safeguard for us that, like everything else, is found in Christ. Love is also, so we can know that if we're in Christ.
That's right.
We won't love the wrong thing. Okay, that the love that we have, we can know that's genuine. You know, so that. So what it does, it's kind of a check for us.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So everything, we can, it's not that complicated for us, actually. We know that we dwell in Christ, and we walk in the Spirit, and we resided in him. And all these things will be. So God has done this. He's put all these things in Christ, that all we got to do is focus on Jesus, and all these things are found in him. So that's what makes it simple. I can use the word that way.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Brother Jonathan.
Yeah, just to comment on those essentials, those traits of God, how we're continually growing in our understanding of these traits of God, and that really in this life we're not going to grasp them all in their fullness. But I would say if a man were to claim that he had a full understanding of any of God's traits, he's actually in a way insulting God's traits, because these are too big for just like mortal man to really comprehend. It's taking something so vast and trying to cram it all in a box that it's impossible to fit in. So yeah, we're always encouraging each other, like, let's search these things out, because mm-hmm. there's always something new to see. And it's going to be that way till we leave this world, really. There's always motivation to seek more.
Amen.
You're looking at Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 10, 11. I really think, Brother Paul, and this is an exposition of what God has done, what God intended to do, what he has done, and what he's going to do. We've talked about all that before, the expansive nature of the love of God, and it expands back into time as well. In due time, Christ died. See, God appointed this from the foundation of the world, from before time began.
Mm-hmm.
He appointed these things. And he commended his love toward us. His love was already there. We just didn't know.
Mm-hmm.
It had to be expounded. It had to be opened up, revealed. Some translations say demonstrated. Some of the newer translations say demonstrated. Commended and demonstrated has different aspects to it, but they're both true. He's shown us these things, and he's shown us that it's good. He commends it to us. You want to have these good things, but you got to come to Jesus. He's the only place. We were reconciled by the death of his son. We shall be saved by his life, by whom we have now received the atonement. All of that past, present, and future that God is working, the expansive, enormous, immense nature of the love of God.
Yeah, it had to have a point where it was experientially accomplished before the transition was made there. I wanted to real quick just mention that in the judgment, whenever all the redeemed and those holy angels and holy creatures that we just have mention of in the Revelation, and perhaps others that we haven't heard of yet, whenever that's all put together with all the aspects of God's glory and how he's worked and everything, and mankind is going to have a significant part in this, but we're going to see even more of his glory, not only in what he did with us, but how he worked in the heavenlies as well.
That's right.
Sister Barb, I think you had your hand up.
Something that I've continued to think about as we've discussed these things is 1 John chapter 4 and verse 12. Mm-hmm. It says, if we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us.
That's right.
And think about that, what we've said about it having a target, the love of God being focused, and things like that. It has a purpose. Mm-hmm. And as we enter in, he's bestowed it, as we receive it, and then we enter in and fellowship with that expression, mm-hmm. then his love is actually being made perfect mm-hmm. in us.
Amen.
It's being shown for what he gave it intending to do. Mm-hmm. Then in the end, the culmination of all things is that God would be fully seen and comprehended. Mm-hmm. That's the perfection that we're all working toward and showing
Amen.
Love.
Amen.
Yeah, that perfecting in us also... And you might have been saying this, and I might not have grabbed it, but that perfecting is that working in us the things that, that God has designed and the glory that he receives from others that, that behold it. So I think you were saying all of those things. That's what I was getting anyway. I keep forgetting this every time that... Okay, go ahead to another comment. I'll probably remember it while you're commenting and forget it again.
What Sister Barb just said, you know, that sometimes I've witnessed in my own experience that I'll see someone else exhibit this manner of love.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it teaches me that that's what he's talking about.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right. And the assembly of the saints and uh-huh. stuff. I know what I was going to say. People have such a hard time with... you know, having to make these high walls around whether you have faith or not or understanding. And I hear the scripture from time to time. I remember in my youth particularly where, yeah, it was a scripture, but there was no heart affection for it. They talked about Jesus like he was some stone monument somewhere.
Yeah.
You know, they said the right things, but you didn't sense that there was this attachment to him, this desire for him, that if you transgressed and found out that you weren't, like, really sorry for it because it was against him and it hurt you. There just wasn't that kind of... This love, see, that's what makes these other things profitable to us. If you know, you can know the whole Bible and be able to quote it backwards.
Yeah.
It would not do you any good to be your condemnation if this love is absent.
Amen.
Means you did not understand what you read. You did not believe what you read. Sister Ada.
We've already affirmed this, but that phrase bestowed on us, so often I think there's this visual of something being poured on us.
Yes.
But... this is actually distinguishing the love of God that is at work in the believer.
That's right.
It's given to us as our own, mm-hmm. almost like a commission, that it's the power of God at work in us, toward us, and through us, that he bestowed this love on us.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, any last comments? All right, we're going to go ahead and close. That's really all I had. So, our Holy Father in heaven, we thank you that our faith includes this love that you have had toward us, the opening up of that. But Father, that it also and preeminently causes us to enter into an understanding of your Son and what he actually did and how he pleased you and how that we are pleasing to you in him. Father, we would know thee. This is eternal life. And we would ask that you would reveal to us more of your Son, for in him we have knowledge of thee. Now, Lord, we ask your blessing upon the remainder of our day. We ask that you would bless those that have prepared for us our breakfast, and that our fellowship, Lord, that help us to be mindful, to be more aware of this love and how it is being demonstrated in us all and to us all, and that we might give thee great glory on that occasion. For we ask it in Christ's name. Amen.